A very warm welcome to our presentation on the cloud computing project that we have built on the topic, Understanding SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. Following are our group members, Harshit Malhotra, Dev Patel, Dhruv Yadav, Piyush Priyadarshi, and myself, Eshwara Mahapatra. Now, let's first see what are cloud services. Cloud services are on-demand services that are available to users via the network from vendor servers. They're easy to use, scalable, and are fully managed by a services provider. Here we have three different types of services under cloud services whose implementation we have used in this project. First is IaaS. It offers hardware environment services, kind of storage services like database or disk storage or virtual servers. Second is PaaS, cloud computing model where a third-party provider delivers hardware and software tools to users over the internet. Usually, these tools are needed for application development. A PaaS provider hosts the hardware and software on its own. SaaS. It offers software. Applications are based on a pay-as-you-go basis. The application will be accessible to any device with a network connection. SaaS applications are typically accessed via web browsers. Now, let's get started with why we have even used AWS in our project. So AWS offers the broadest and deepest set of AI and ML services with unmatched flexibility. You can accelerate the adoption of machine learning with AWS SageMaker. Models that previously took months and required specialized expertise can now be built in weeks or even days. AWS offers the most comprehensive cloud offering optimized for machine learning. More machine learning happens at AWS than anywhere else. And these are some of the services being provided by AWS, which is like Amazon EC2, Amazon RDS, AWS Direct Connect, Elastic IP, etc. Now, I would like to call my team member Dhruv to give an insight on AWS Deep Composer.
So here we have our example of SaaS, AWS Deep Composer, and it is the world's first musical keyboard combined with generative AI services. And it has 32 key and 2 octave keyboard designed for developers. So here is a pictorial representation of the same, which consists keyboard, console, and last step. So our AWS Deep Composer uses generative AI, or specifically generative adversarial networks. Here we have two networks, one generator network and another discriminator network. This scenario can be compared to a scenario where these all musicians are playing a song with different instruments, and here is a conductor who is giving their feedback and telling them about their mistakes and improving the quality of music. So, talking about the workflow of AWS Deep Composer, first we take input through the Deep Composer keyboard or the virtual keyboard as an input melody. Then we select our generative model and choose our genre like jazz, rock, pop, and then after that we can publish our SoundCloud, publish the track to SoundCloud or any MIDI file. So here is a screenshot of the site, and here first we will select Music Studio. Then first we have our input melody. Here is Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Then we play it. Then here we select different generative AI techniques. They are of three types: GAN, ARCNN, and Transformer. Generative algorithms are also of two types. Here we have chosen MuseGAN, and here we have chosen our model jazz, rock, pop, or any other. And we have generated the composition. Here we, as we can see, we have acoustic grand piano, acoustic bass, drums. All these three components are merged with the input melody and the output is there. So here is how we can use the virtual keyboard with the piano and get our input melody. And here we now listen to, after the completing all the steps, we listen to our output melody. Now I would like Harshit to continue.
Thank you, Dhruv, for the offer. So moving forward with AWS Deep Composer, seeing how AWS Deep Composer works and what lies it's under the hood. So in the diagram, we can see there is a lot of jargon. Let's first discuss these jargons. The first one is a DynamoDB. It is a database manager. It could manage a large amount of data traffic over tables from multiple servers and can provide a good performance. Second would be the Amazon SageMaker. So what Amazon SageMaker is, it is a platform that provides cloud machine learning and ML models could be deployed on embedded system and even to the edge devices. Regardless of the ML expertise, one can easily deploy ML models over the SageMaker. Here is a pictorial representation how Amazon SageMaker would work. First, we could choose our framework. Second, fine-tune with it, choose our target hardware platform. Second, train the model using Amazon SageMaker Neo and then deploy it on the cloud. The next would be the Amazon API Gateway. What Amazon API Gateway does is it connects to the different backend services the developer can use to create, publish and maintain, monitor different applications. The applications can access data, use business logic and functionality from the backend services. Here is a diagram which represents how Amazon API Gateway connects to different background services and provides the data. Another is the AWS Lambda. It is an event-driven, serviceless computing platform provided by the Amazon. It is a computing services that runs the code in response to an event and automatically manages the computing resources required by the code. It can support multiple languages. We can see the AWS Lambda Flowwork, the API Gateway, invokes the Lambda function and Lambda function triggers the Amazon DynamoDB. Next is the step function. So AWS step function is a low code visual workflow service that developers could use to automate IT work, build business processes, build data and machine learning pipelines. The workflow manager failures, retrieves and parallelization, service integration and observability. So developers can focus on high value business logic. So coming back, how the Amazon Deep Composer works. Seeing the diagram, we can see that input melody is captured by the AWS Deep Composer console. Then consoles make a backend call to the AWS API that triggers a Lambda function. Then there is a bookkeeping recorded in the DynamoDB. And next, the execution Lambda function performs an inference query to the SageMaker, which hosts the model and the training inference container. The query is run on generative AI model. The model generates a composition. The composition is returned. The user could hear the composition in the console. The user can also publish this to the SoundCloud. So Amazon is just basically using a GAN. So what are its benefits? That we can also fine tune some hyperparameters of this GAN for our advantage. For example, in an training, we could increase the number of epochs. This could make the training longer, but would produce a better output than the learning data. So learning data is how rapidly the weights and biases of each network are updated during a training. A higher learning data might allow the network to explore a wider set of modal weights, but might pass over some optimal weights. The third is the update ratio. It means that for every one iteration of generator training, we can use multiple iteration of discriminator training. This allows the generator to learn more quickly, but could increase the overall training time. Moving forward to training architecture. So in the AWS Deep Composer Cloud, we can see how the training architecture works. Using this diagram, we can see that first, in the Deep Composer console, the user enters the training configuration and the training starts. The backend consists of an API layer, API gateway with a Lambda function that requests to the DynamoDB. Then a triggered Lambda function that starts the training workflow. It then uses the Amazon step function to launch C training job on the Amazon SageMaker. The status is continually monitored and updated to the DynamoDB. The console continues to poll the backend for the status of the training job and update the results so that the live users can see how the model is training. Moving forward, I would like to call the next candidate.
Up until now, we were using software as a service with the example of AWS Deep Composer. Now we'll look at how we can host our ML model using IaaS architecture provided by AWS EC2. Further, we'll also look how we can do the same with much less effort using PaaS architecture provided by Heroku. Now let's discuss the ML model that we are creating. To show the implementation of PaaS and IaaS, we will be creating a simple salary prediction model. This model will take experience, test score, and interview score as the input and give us the predicted salary. The experience, test score, and interview score are our independent variables, and salary will be a dependent variable. The model is then trained using linear regression. So in this piece of code, we have made some required modifications to the data set and later have trained it using the linear regression model. Afterwards, using the Pickle library, we are dumping the entire model into .pkl extension, which will convert it into a byte stream. After building this ML model, we will convert it into a web application using the Flask framework. So let's discuss Flask. Flask is a micro web framework written in Python. It is classified as a micro framework because it doesn't require particular tools or libraries. It has no database abstraction layer, form validation, or any other components where pre-existing third-party libraries provide common functions. However, Flask supports extensions that can add application features as if they were implemented in Flask itself. Extensions exist for object relational, mappers, form validation, upload handling, face open authentication technologies, and several common framework-related rules. This means Flask provides you with tools, libraries, and technologies that allow you to build a web application. This web application can be some web pages, a blog, a wiki, or go as big as web-based calendar application or a commercial website. Now, I would like to call Dave to tell you something about AWS EC2.
Now, we will talk about AWS EC2, which is a infrastructure as a service provider. It provides scalable computing capacity in the Amazon Web Service Cloud. Using Amazon EC2 eliminates need to invest in hardware upfront so we can develop and deploy application faster. It uses pay-as-you-go model, so we are charged as and when we use computing resources. In AWS EC2, we are provided with virtual computing environment, or we can say Amazon machine image, which are known as instances. For each instance, we can choose from various configuration of CPU, memory, storage, and networking capacity. In order to use EC2 instance, we need to create an Amazon Web Service account. After creating the account, we will go to EC2 service and click on launch instance. Now we'll choose our preferred Amazon machine image. Here we are choosing the machine image consisting Ubuntu 8.04 as the OS. Next. Now we will choose an instance type which specifies the number of CPUs, memory size, instance storage type, and network performance. Here we are opting for the free tier with the minimal functionality as it satisfies our requirement. Next. This page shows that our instance is up and running without any problem. Next page. Now, before hosting our ML model as a web application, we will create a custom security group, which will be responsible for managing inbound and outbound traffic to our instance. Next page. We will create a new security group with full access so that anyone can access as long as they have the public DNS, which the creation of the new security group named new group is shown in the below picture. Next. Now, in order for this security group to do its work, we will add the custom security group to the network interface of our instance. by right clicking on the network interface ID and changing the security group. It will attach the security group with our instance so that we can properly imply the inbound and outbound rule that we have specified. Now I'd like to call Piyush to explain further.
Now that our instance is fully functional, how do we go about accessing the server from our local computer? This is where PuTTY comes into play, which helps us to access our Ubuntu terminal locally. Authentication of the person who wants to access the app is done through PuTTY Gen. When the instance is launched, we are provided a key pair. If we feed the key pair to PuTTY Gen, we get the private key, which we can use to authenticate ourselves thereafter. Next slide. To facilitate file transfer between our local computer and the server, we use WinSCP or Windows Secure Copy, which is a free and open source client for protocols like SFTP, FTP, WebDAV, Amazon S3, and SCP for the Microsoft Windows platform. Next slide. Here we can see the WinSCP in action. The left side of the screen is our local computer, and the right side is a machine image. You can see that the templates folder app.py, app.py, model.pkl, and requirements.txt we have copied from our local computer to the machine image. These are necessary files, as we'll see later. Next slide. Along with the above files, we will access the command prompt and download the necessary dependencies in order to run our salary prediction model with the help of PuTTY. The next step would be to invoke our model from the terminal using PuTTY and start the process on the virtual machine so that we can access it remotely, provided we have the necessary authentication. Next. Using the provided public DNS, we can access the hosted model through a web browser. This is what it looks like. Here we can input the experience test score and interview score, and we will get a predictor value of what the employee salary should be. Next. Then now we looked at how to deploy our ML model to the Amazon EC2 IaaS platform. Now we'll deploy the same model using the Heroku PaaS platform. Heroku is a cloud platform that lets one build, deliver, monitor, and scale apps on the web. With Heroku, we just need to be concerned about our application and the data, like information regarding the APIs, etc. And the obscure details like maintaining the runtime of the services, management of OS, managing access rights to the application, etc., are abstracted from us. Applications on Heroku are run in containers called Dino and typically have a unique domain used to route HTTP requests to the correct Dino. The Dinos are spread across the Dino grid, which consists of several servers. Next slide. After training a model and creating a web app for it using the Flask web framework, we committed the code to our GitHub repo. Later, we connected Heroku with this repo containing the implementation of our application and supporting information like required runtime dependencies, which is in the form of a text document. And the rest was automatically handled by Heroku. Next slide. Here we have two options for deployment. We can either do automatic deploys, which will automatically build a new version and deploy it whenever changes are made on the selected branch, that is the main branch in this case. Or we can opt for manual deploy, in which we will need to deploy the new version of the app manually after making changes. Next. On pressing deploy, all the necessary dependencies required for the model to run specified in the requirement.txt file will be downloaded and installed automatically. Finally, we can access our application through the provided hyperlink. Next. The main takeaways from this project are that we got to see the differences between SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS in terms of control, customization, and convenience. IaaS offers the most control and customizability, while SaaS is most convenient to use. This concludes our presentation on this topic. Thank you.